from around the world. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Jan. I am co-moderator together with my colleague Christian Zeiner, and we would like to welcome our speaker for today, Dr. Amanda Guiraldelli, PhD, for our Introduction to Analytical Quality by Design, AQBD Principles. And yes, we are going to start. This will be a 1-hour webinar. Everyone is automatically on mute. And if you have any questions, please be so kind to type them into the Q&A box. You should be able to see. If you're working from a laptop, it should be in the lower right corner. And we'll be fielding those questions as we go along. Please allow me to just briefly introduce Amanda. She is a graduate in pharmacy biochemistry and holds a PhD in analytical chemistry from the University of São Paulo in Brazil. Her focus on her thesis was plant metabolomics and by UHPCL HRMS GCMS, an application of QBD principles in analytical procedure development. Currently, Amanda is a scientific affairs manager with us at USP and visiting professor at the Federal University of Campinas, Unicamp at the Institute of Chemistry. She's mentoring students in research project on AQBD. She's a specialist in chromatography and mass spectrometry and has more than 12 years of experience in R&D areas with strong expertise in analytical procedure development and validation, AQBD, stability studies of drug products, analysis of pharmaceutical impurities and degradation products, chemometrics, omics science, and characterization of compendial standards. Previously, she worked as senior scientist at USP Reference Standard Laboratory for 8 years with characterization of compendial standards. She also worked as an R&D scientist in the Brazilian pharmaceutical industry and visiting scientist at Technische Universität in Berlin, Germany, working on proteins characterization by LC-HRMS and at Leiden University in Netherlands at the Center for Proteomics and Metabolomics, working on method development for characterization of biological samples. She's also a member of North Jersey Chromatography Group of the American Chemical Society. So yes, thank you again for joining us. And Amanda, I'll give the floor to you. We will have at the very end, once you leave and close our webinar window, there will be a short survey. So please take your time, if you can, to fill out our survey. It's very important to us for our quality purposes. We really appreciate your feedback. Please be forthright with us. It really helps us well to improve on the experience that you have with us. And yeah, thank you again.
Yeah, so hi, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Jan, for the kind introduction. It's really a great pleasure for me to have the opportunity to provide you a brief introduction to the analytical quality by design principles. Hopefully you can see all my screen, right, Jan, Christian?
Yes, we can, Amanda.
I hope everyone.
Okay, great. Well, and the agenda for this talk today is the following. So we are gonna start our discussion discussing about the AQBD concept, and then I would like to share with you a brief overview of the USP General Chapter 1220, which talks about analytical procedure lifecycle. And then I'm gonna share a case study where we are gonna develop together a method by using UHPLC UV, using the AQBD principle. So the idea here is to apply the AQBD elements to the method development. And then the last topic would be to discuss about the benefits of applying AQBD to method development. Well, the first question I have here is, what is AQBD? What is the AQBD concept? So if you have a look at the ICH guideline Q8 for pharmaceutical development, you're going to find the AQBD concept, which is the following. It is a systematic approach to development, which emphasizes product and process understanding and process control based on sound science and quality risk management. And in the analytical procedure environment, we can use the term AQBD, which stands for analytical quality by design, referring to the application of quality by design principles to the method development. And USP has several public standards addressing the different stages of the procedure lifecycle. For instance, the chapter 1225 on validation of procedures, 1226 on verification of procedures and so on. And here, I also would like to highlight the new proposed chapter 1220 on analytical procedure life cycle, which presents an holistic approach for management of the knowledge and procedure life cycle. You will also find in the Pharmacopeia Forum several stimuli articles published by the USP addressing different key aspects of the procedure life cycle. And you're going to see that all these key elements are almost the same key elements of the AQBD, right? Because the procedure life cycle is driven by the quality by design principles. Well, with this slide here, I would like to show you the evolution of the quality by design concept and how this has been applied over the last years. So we know very well that Dr. Joseph Judan was the person who first introduced the quality by design concept. He was an engineer and management consultant who advocated for the quality management, right? So he has written several books around quality management and also QBD. And one of them that I would like to highlight today, it is drawn on quality by design. So where you're gonna find the quality trilogy, which is the following. So we initiate with quality planning, which is the essence of quality by design. Then we do the quality control and improvement, right? And he was used to say that quality should be designed into a product, and most of the quality problems are related to the way in which a product was designed in the first place. And after the year 2000, we started seeing FDA encouraging the industry to apply and adopt risk-based approaches and QBD principles in drug product development and manufacturing. And they were used to say at that time already that increased testing doesn't necessarily improve product quality. The quality must be built into the drug product, right? In the drug product design. And this is one of the most famous concepts of quality by design or description for quality by design, that the quality must be built into the product design. And in our case for procedures, the AQBD, during the AQBD, we need to build the quality into the procedure design, right? Well, between 2004 and 2012, we have seen several ICH guidelines being published outlining QBD concept, such as the ICH guideline Q8, Q9, Q10, Q11. We can also include here in this list the Q12 on product lifecycle, which is also driven by QBD concepts. And in 2011, the EMA and the FDA launched a pilot program to assess the implementation of QBD in drug product development and manufacturing. And one of the main objectives of this pilot program was to ensure a consistent implementation of the ICH guidelines outlining QBD concepts. And it was also seen as a way to facilitate for regulators to share the regulatory decisions on a very new regulatory concept, which is quality by design. And then in 2017, the AQBD working group of the International Consortium for Innovation and Quality, they published a very interesting survey to assess the implementation of AQBD. So you're going to see in the next slides that the AQBD workflow is consisted of different elements, right? So we see that we can apply design of experiments, but it's also we also need to use quality risk management tools, right? And we see that at that time, 2017, 70% of the respondents of this survey said that they were already implementing some of those elements, right? And with this survey, it's also interesting for us to see which were the challenges flagged by the industry, right? And one of them was exactly that we don't have actually guidelines to show us how to implement the AQBD concepts. Well, in 2018, the ICH shared that they will be creating a new ICH guideline, the Q14, to discuss about analytical procedure development. So they will be discussing about different approaches for method development, traditional and enhanced approaches. And we are expecting to have access to this text still this year. So they are about to be to publish this for public consultation. So let's see if the ICH will publish still this year this guideline for revision. And a very interesting survey was also published by the regulatory agency of UK in partnership with British Pharmacopeia. So they published in 2019 a hypothetical monograph, which was developed using AQbD principles. And basically, they published this consultation, including some aspects of AQbD in this monograph, such as the analytical target profile, which is basically the objective of the method, and also including the operating range or the method operable design region. And I'm going to explain you about the concepts for these key elements of AQBT later. And last year in 2020, they published the consultation response showing how to apply AQBT to pharmacopeia standards development. And we saw with this consultation response, a very positive reaction of the stakeholders, showing their interest in seeing in the monographs the ATP and the MODR, right? And last year, the USP also published the chapter 1220 on procedural life cycle, also discussing about some key elements of the AQBD. And at the beginning of this year, USP and BP organized a workshop on AQBD and life cycle. Procedure life cycle, and where we had really a nice engagement from the participants, especially with great questions around how to implement the AQBD in the industry and to develop pharmacopeia standards. And in April of this year, the BP published in their website a supplementary chapter for public consultation around the application of AQBD to pharmacopeia methods. So we have seen that regulators and the industry, they are increasingly embracing the quality by design concept, right? And we have seen over these last years that some quality paradigm shifts moving from using a quality by testing approach, to moving to a quality by design approach, and also moving from using a compliance-driven approach to use risk-based approach to improve the quality of medicines, right? Well, we know that guidelines to show us how to implement the AQBD approach, they are still lacking, right? However, we can adapt the quality by design workflow applied to drug manufacturing and drug formulation. We can use and adapt this workflow, we can use in the analytical procedure context, right? And here on the slide, I'm gonna show you exactly this workflow that we can use and apply to develop methods using quality by design principles. So the first step is to establish the analytical target profile. And this will be the objective of the method, take into consideration the performance requirements for that method. And then we go to the stage one of the procedure life cycle, where we start with deciding or selecting the critical procedure attributes. Those will be the analytical responses that we'll be monitoring during the procedure design. Those responses should reflect the method quality and good performance of this method. Then you're gonna select the critical procedure parameters. And those are the analytical conditions or factors that will be studied and seeing how the changes in these analytical conditions will impact on analytical responses. And for this reason, it's important that we use our prior knowledge. We can also use here some risk assessment tools, and I'm going to show you an example in the case study, to help us to select those critical parameters which may have a significant impact on method performance. And then we are going to do some experimentation, right? So we can use a systematic way of doing experiments. We can use design of experiment, run some screening tests, optimization designs to optimize performance and robustness. And here, just to give an idea how we can conduct those studies. So let's assume that we have a process we would like to optimize. This would be a method to quantify some impurities using UHPLC UV. So the process will be basically the separation of the target impurities from adjacent picks, for example. So first, we are going to select the input factors. They could be columns, pH of mobile phase, organic solvent. We are going to select a suitable type of design of experiment. And then we are going to acquire data. And we are going to monitor the responses. They could be resolution between critical pair, number of picks with resolution above 1.5, tailing factor, retention factor of a specific impurity. And then that we have the response. And we know with our input factors, we are able to do regression analysis and generate a prediction model, which will predict the responses based on the analytical conditions, right? Right now, we are able to identify conditions for optimized responses and optimize the method itself. And after validating those prediction models by conducting statistical analysis, we have access to the knowledge space. And the knowledge space will be a space where we know how the analytical responses will behave based on the changes of the analytical conditions. And within this knowledge space, after conducting risk assessment, so here we are gonna also estimate the uncertainty associated with the results, with the responses, right? Now we are able to select or delimitate the method operable design region, which is the MODR, right? And within this operating range, all set factors combination will have a settlement performance and robustness. And with this, after validating the MODR, we are able to identify risks and propose control for these risks, right? To avoid this risk or minimize possible sources of variability. And we can then establish some analytical control strategies to help us to assure that the method is fit for its intended purpose along the whole procedure life cycle. And then we go to stage two of the procedure life cycle, which is method validation, followed by the stage three, which is performance verification. And we see that all those stages are interconnected. It's much easier now to conduct the knowledge management and the lifecycle management, right? So we see that applying this approach, this will allow a feedback and feed forward interaction among all stages. And this will give us the chance to maintain or to assure that the performance of the method is great along the complete life cycle of the procedure. Well, the evaluation of the risks posed by the variables or analytical conditions, and also the how the variables will impact on performance should be based on scientific knowledge, prior experience, and also experimentation. And design of experiment, it is a very powerful data analysis and collection and data collection tool that we can use in several experimental situations. And we can also apply this to develop methods, right? This will help us especially to understand how the variables will impact on performance through risk assessment, experimentation, and modeling as needed, right? It's very common that at the beginning of the method development, we don't have so much information about how the factors, possible factors, may impact on performance. We know a little bit about this based on prior knowledge, right? However, it's sometimes hard for us to estimate or understand which will be the effect of interaction between factors on performance. And in order to gather knowledge, we can start the method development by conducting some screening tests. So here you see some different types of design of experiment that you can use for this purpose. Basically, the main goal will be to understand the effect of parameters on performance. And then we are able to apply some quality risk management tools here. We are going to select best performance conditions and also workable regions in order to further refine them using an optimization design. Basically, during the screening design, we will be focusing on selecting and identifying variables which have a significant impact on selectivity. And then we are gonna select those conditions, run the optimization design. So here you're gonna find some suitable types for optimization design. And the greatest goal here is to optimize performance, right? So we'll also be applying here and using quality risk management tools to identify risks and propose how to manage those risks. Here, during the optimization design, it's pretty important that we can use some approach and strategies to estimate the uncertainty associated with the responses, right, with the results. And then we can delimitate the operating range, assuring that we have an operating range where we can assure the good performance and good robustness of the method. And here, during the optimization design, we'll be also focusing on accuracy and precision, not just only on selectivity. And then based on a great understanding about the method that we acquired during this method design, we are able to establish suitable control strategies for the method. Well, and what about the current practice for validation? So we know that the pharmaceutical industry, they are developing and validating the methods in alignment with ICH guidelines, with USP guidances, right? However, the method development, method transfer have become an exercise more focused on satisfying regulatory recommendations rather than trying to understand, identify the sources of variability and trying to minimize those sources, right? Sometimes those guidances are treated as in a checkbox manner, right? Well, and those guidances in general will recommend some performance characteristics, right, to be assessed during validation. They will be showing us some default criteria that we should meet with the procedure, right? And sometimes there is not a transparent and rationale behind the establishment of those criteria. Those criteria should be selected and established during method design based on the identified risks that we are evaluating during method design. And all of those performance characteristics here, they are a good indicator of a good performance, right? However, sometimes this indicator here cannot provide a direct measure of quality or error associated with results. And this current practice will give less consideration to understand the total measurement and how this can impact the decisions to be made, especially if a product is out of specification or not, right? So we see that by using an approach which gives us the chance to estimate the variability and uncertainty associated with the measurement, this is pretty important since this variability may pose a significant challenge, especially when we have a result which is out of specification. And here, just a brief introduction to the chapter 1220 on procedure lifecycle. This chapter will present a framework which will show the procedure lifecycle approach is consisted of 3 stages. The stage 1, procedure design, which is the method development, stage 2, which is validation, and then verification of performance. And we see that all of those stages, they are interconnected, right? And this will give us the chance to promote continuous improvement. And you're gonna see that this general chapter in this approach will emphasize the importance of using scientific knowledge and quality risk management to manage the procedure life cycle and showing the importance of considering the estimation of measurement uncertainty and also establishing tolerances for the measurement uncertainty in order to give us an idea how to make the correct decision about the product and about the performance of the method. Well, and I think at this point, you may have in your mind some benefits of applying AQBD to method development. But before we summarize those benefits, I would like to share a case study where we developed a stability indicating method using UHPLC UV to quantify some impurities in a drug substance. Well, the first step, as we saw, it is the analytical target profile establishment, right? So here for this particular case study, the ATP will be a procedure to quantify ondansetron-related compounds. We have 7 impurities in the drug substance ondansetron hydrochloride, right? And in parallel to the ATP establishment, we need to start doing quality planning. which is the initial risk assessment for method design. We are going to start here gathering prior knowledge, knowledge about which kind of process impurities, the CPMs we may find in drug product, which kind of degradation products we may see arising during the stability of that product, right? And then we need to access their chemical structures, evaluate their physicochemical properties, because this will guide us to select a suitable technique to quantify those impurities with the required sensitivity, with good selectivity. In this example, we have ondosetron, which is the API, which is a non-polar compound with basic moiety. We see here that we may explore reverse at phase chromatography, but we may face some challenge, especially because we have the impurity F and E, which are very polar compounds. We may face some poor retention of those impurities in reverse at phase chromatography. We also have ionizable compounds, right? And neutral compounds. And we may also explore the addition of ion pair reagents to improve the retention factor of impurity F and E, and also change the selectivity for the ionizable compounds. And on the next slide, I show you the risk assessment tool we used to help us to select the critical parameters, right? And here, the idea is not to go into details about these parameters, but just to show you the tool that I used, which is a cause-effect diagram, where we can see the parameters, which are the critical parameters we selected for the screening one. Basically, those factors selected here, we selected them based on their potential impact on selectivity. Because we know that in chromatography, a primary goal is to have good resolution between the target compounds and other impurities or adjacent peaks. And we know that the resolution in chromatography is described based on three terms, right? The retention factor, the efficiency, and also selectivity. And we know that if selectivity will have the greatest impact on resolution. For this reason, we are selecting for the screening one conditions and parameters which may have a significant impact on selectivity. Well, here we have the overall strategy for this method development. So the first thing, we did the risk assessment, we purchased the non-impurities, and we prepared a solution with a mixture of impurities and the API. And then we run the screening one using design of experiment. So we use here the optimal design. We screened 4 different columns, 4 different ion pair reagents, different organic solvents. We also blended the organic solvents to explore different selectivities of organic solvents. And we also explored gradient slope. And after running the screening one, doing data interpretation, we could select the best performance conditions which were further explored using ice screening tool. So basically here, we added a new level of column. We added the Zurbach's bonus column. Since we saw, based on the screening one, that the BEH shoot column gave the best performance, and we would like to explore here a similar technology, since BEH shoot has a polar group embedded in the alkyl chain. So we selected the Zurbach's bonus column, which also has a polar group embedded in the alkyl chain, but now trying to reduce the percentage of carbolone and trying to explore different interactions between the stationary phase and the analytes. And we also added a new column, a new factor, which is column temperature, since we know that this factor may have a significant impact on selectivity of ionizable compounds. And we are working with ionizable compounds. And then the best conditions we selected to be further refined using an optimization design. So here we use a G-optimal design, fitting the data into a cubic model. And we run also the in silico robustness test, and we could delimitate the MODR. And finally, after defining the final condition, we could conduct the stress testing, selectivity studies, and validation. Well, for the screening tool, let's see how we did the data interpretation, right? So basically, we ran the screening tool using design of experiment. We generated the prediction model, And after validating those prediction models, we could then project all the responses that we are monitoring the quality, that they are using to monitor the quality of the method that you can see here. And here are the acceptable criteria for those responses. We are projecting those predicted responses on graphics. So those are here the acceptable performance region graphics. And the golden rule to interpret those data is to find white area. Because where we have white area, it means that all acceptance criteria for all responses were met. So we have good performance. So we see here that by using the bonus column with NFPA and HFPA, we have white area with the different column temperatures. You see here that we have white area. We have good performance using this column. We can also further extract knowledge by evaluating here that those graphics from the BH shield column. We see that we also have white area, right? But we need to limit the use of this column to the use of organic solvent acetonitrile, because the corner of those triangles here are related to the use of different organic solvents. So we see that using BH shield column and 100% of acetonitrile, we can have great performance, and we can increase this when we increase the column temperature to 45 Celsius degree. And because we have a great flexibility to work with bonus column with the different conditions, we selected this column for further refinement using an optimization design. Well, we can further extract knowledge from the data. We see here the counterplots obtained during the screening 2 for the response resolution between a critical pair, which is ondansetron and the impurity D. And we clearly see here that by increasing the temperature of the column, right, by setting the temperature at 45 Celsius degree and using the organic solvent acetonitrile, which is the A corner here, we are increasing the resolution. And for sure, this will be the conditions we'll be selecting to further refine using optimization design. However, we still see some issues, right? So we still see here some poor retention of the very polar compounds, impurity E and F. And we also have an additional critical pair, which is between the impurity B, which is an ionizable compound, and impurity C, which is a neutral compound. And during this screening too, we evaluated the different ion pair reagents with a concentration of 5 millimolar. So the idea was, before we go to the optimization design, let's just try to optimize the ion pair reagent concentration. So we increase it, this concentration, and we use here, we run some analysis using HFPA at 10 millimolar. And for sure, we were expecting that the ionizable compounds would have a longer retention in the alkyl chain, so we could solve the very poor retention we had before for the impurity E and F. And because impurity B is ionizable compound, it was retained longer in the column. Impurity C is a neutral compound, it didn't move, right? And we could solve these issues here and select the best concentration of HFPA, which is 10 millimolar, right? Well, now we understand how we selected the best performance conditions from screening 2 to be further optimized using an optimization design. So here we explored 4 different factors, right? So we explored the concentration of the ion pair reagent, which is the HFPA. So we saw that we selected 10 millimolar as set point, and we are gonna explore around its set point. The same for column temperature, flow rate, and gradient slope. And we use here the optimal design, as I said, and here are the results. So after running the optimization design, we can build some graphics to extract knowledge from the data, right? So here we have the knowledge space. Remember that the golden rule to interpret the data here is to find white area, because it means that all conditions will give us an acceptable mean performance and good robustness. However, at this stage, we still didn't conduct risk assessment. We still didn't identify or estimate the potential uncertainty and variability that might be associated with the results, right? So we don't have information on robustness. We cannot just select a final condition based on this study. And basically, when we are running the optimization design, we have a single injection for each experiment, right? So we don't have access to the uncertainty associated with that measurement of that response. And what you're going to do here, you're going to simulate multiple injections in order to assess the uncertainty associated with that measurement. So here we use Monte Carlo simulation to do this, and also running the in silico robustness study, where we are going to simulate the variation around the set point for each organ, for each factor, right? And see how this will impact on the response. Now we are going to have new prediction models take into consideration the variability associated with the measurement. And now we are able to identify risks and select final conditions with great robustness. And the second stage of the quality risk management here during optimization design will be the establishment of a specification for performance characteristics for the critical attributes. And then we are able to calculate the process capability index, which will give us an idea about the ability of the process to meet the specifications. And then we are able to select those conditions, which will give us a great performance and also robustness. And after conducting and identifying of risks, we are able to delimitate the method operable design region. And we need to validate this MODR. And as I said, we don't have any protocol to help us to validate properly this MODR. Basically, what we are proposing in this case is we will conduct the validation of prediction models by doing statistical analysis, and then select some working points within the MODR and do some verification runs. Then we are able to compare the experimental and also predicted responses, right, and validate the MODR. And then we are going to optimize the responses, and I'm going to show you how we did this for this particular case study. Well, let's go back again to the knowledge space. Now we are going to project the responses predicted by the new prediction models, now considering the variability associated with the responses, right? And when we do this, we see, we get a surprise because we don't have any white area anymore. It means that we have good performance, but we don't have good robustness. So we cannot select a final condition here. And this is the beauty of using the quality by design, because during the method design, we are able to identify the risks and design the method in a way to prevent it to fail before it fails during method transfer, during the analysis, the routing analysis using this procedure. And in this case, we are designing the method in a way, changing the settings of some factors to find a robust condition which will give us a good robustness and good performance. So if you see, if you have a look at this graphic here, we are applying some constraints for the organic solvent, the percentage of this organic solvent. So we had before a range between 38 to 45% of organic solvent. And now we are applying some constraint to find a robust area where we can assure that the MODR will give us conditions with a supplement performance and robustness. And here just to illustrate how we can conduct the MODR validation after doing the statistical analysis of prediction models and evaluating the ability of prediction of those models, we can run some verification runs. So here we selected the edges of the MODR and the target condition. We run verification runs, and we could monitor the performance in all of those points, right? So we see here that we have great performance, we have a great selectivity with nice resolution between all the target impurities, we have great retention factor for the baripolar compounds, and we have a final condition where we have a single method that we can quantify all the impurities, right? And here just to illustrate how we can further optimize the response after delimiting the MODR. So we can use response surfaces, contour plots to help to optimize the response. And here's an example. So we see the counter plot and response surface for the response resolution between the impurity B and C, which is one of the critical pairs of this study. And we see that if we set the column temperature at 45 Celsius degree, and we have the concentration of ion pair reagent set at around 10 millimolar, 10.5, we are increasing the resolution for impurity B. And this is the final condition. Well, and here you see the final condition. We have a visual graphic with the MODR. We can also have the MODR in a table where we see the operating range, right, which was validated based on quality risk management. And also based on quality risk management tools, we were able to acquire a lot of understanding about the method and identify risks and establish suitable control strategies. In this case, suitable system suitability criteria for us to verify the performance of the method along the whole procedure life cycle. Well, and with this, some concluding remarks will be exactly the benefits of applying quality by design principles to method development. So we see that by applying AQBD to method development, we can first acquire a high degree of understanding about the method, right? We know that one of the key enablers of AQBD, it is to do the management of knowledge and apply quality risk management tools. And we can only identify risks and manage risks if we have a high degree of understanding about the method. And with this, we can also select optimized and robust conditions. We can then access the operating range, which is the MODR, by identifying the risks, proposing some controls for those risks. And we can also understand and control sources of vulnerability and manage the risks. Using QBD, we can also identify the measurement uncertainty and establish tolerances for this measurement uncertainty. And with this, we can establish suitable control strategies, the system suitability criteria. We can also establish a more suitable control requirements for method transfer, right? And we can also increase reliability of deciding if a product is out of specification. So we see a clear benefit here of applying AQBD. It is to improve the quality of medicines, right? And this will help us to, this will facilitate the knowledge and analytical procedure lifecycle management, and also help us to promote continuous improvement for the procedure and quality of medicines. Oh, and this brings me to the end of my presentation. I just would like to share with you a very nice and simple sentence that you're gonna find in the USP Stimuli article on analytical control strategy around the concept of QBD. Well, fundamental to the concept of quality by design is to start with the end in mind. And the start will be the method design, and end will be the quality. So we need to take care and consider build the quality of the procedure and product in the method design, right? Well, and with this, I thank you so much for the attention, and I'll be more than happy to answer any follow-up question that you may have. And feel free to reach out to me in this address in case you have some questions in the future and would like to have some discussions around AQBD. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Christian, would you like to field any questions, answers?
Yes, of course. Thank you, Jan. Hello also from my side. I am Christian, looking over the questions today, and we have a couple of questions. Number one question, as always, or as very often, could we have the slides after the presentation? So Amanda, would we be allowed to make a PDF of the of the PowerPoint and send it to participants?
Sure.
Excellent. Excellent. Thank you very much. So that was question number one. We have also one question. What does the MODR stand for? I think it became later than clear. It was at the very beginning. I think it became later clear. But that's the method operable design region. And this is more or less the equivalent to the design space when we talk about normal quality by design. Sorry, Amanda, now I was answering your question, but maybe you have something to add to that.
Yeah, sure. You are totally correct, Christian. The design space outlined in the Ice Age guidelines, where we apply QBD concept to drug manufacturing, is exactly the same MODR that we are considering for the development of procedures, right? So the methyloperidol design region will be, as I said, a region where we can assure that all conditions will provide us a good performance and good robustness, right? And we can only access this through using a systematic approach to acquire data, to identify risks, and we also need to access the robustness of conditions. Otherwise, we cannot delimitate the MODR. And something very nice to point out here is that by using the MODR in the future, we may have some regulatory flexibility. Why? Because as soon as we are assuring the good performance and robustness of the method, we can in the future make some movements within the MODR and still assure a good performance and robustness, right? And sometimes we know that during the product life cycle, we need to have some changes in the synthetic route of the API, or maybe in the formulation of the drug product. A classical case would be the nitrosamine case, right? Where some manufacturers need to change the synthetic route of some APIs to reduce the level of nitrosamine in the product, or still eliminate this impurity. And this may change the organic impurity profile and can impact on the performance of the procedure. The procedure may not be anymore suitable for that purpose. And for this reason, it's interesting to have a MODR where we can do some movements within the MODR, and we don't need them to go back and redesign the method again and validate everything again when we have those changes in the product lifecycle.
Yeah, thank you very much. We also have very often the question coming up for the plots that were shown, especially on slide 19, but all that goes about the design of experiments. Which software were used there? And can we do the same? That was also a question.
Yeah, sure. Well, for this particular case, we used Fusion software, which is a quality by design software from S-Matrix. However, we have many other software that we can use. I can just share some of them. They would be the ACD AlphaChrome. We also have Chrome Sword. We also have DryLab, Design Expert. And we can also use very simple statistical software such as Minitab. We can also use an open source software, which is the AIR program, right? We can even do design of experiment using Excel.
Very well. Another question. Thank you. Another question we have is AQBD applicable to both isocratic and gradient methods?
Yes. In case we would like to have a gradient, or we'd like to explore the gradient, we can also include this as variable, or we can maintain this as a constant factor. But it's possible to actually, we can explore all parameters that we would like to explore, even using an isocratic method or using gradient. Yes.
Perfect. And another question was, apply the design of experiment if you don't have a linear relationship of variables or variables to responses. Yeah.
So we can also model this. And then we need to know that we might need to use some suitable design of experiment types to allow us, for example, to estimate quadratic terms or higher order terms, right? And normally we are doing this when we are doing optimization designs or using optimization designs, because we are using design types that can give us this opportunity to estimate the quadratic terms, and then we can see some inflection points in case the response is not linear. Yes.
Very well. There are a number of questions. let me see what is a good one here to crush. I think we also need, we will not be able to answer all questions here today, but Amanda gave her email address already, awg@usp.org. You can also send to myself, christian.seine@usp.org. I gave my email address in the chat already. But here is another question for you, Amanda. I realize that automation equipment takes an important role in AQBD, but if this automation is not available, could you give us an estimation of the time that's required to establish the MODR of a method?
Yes, for sure. Yeah, so for sure we can accelerate the method development when we can have an automatic communication between the software and the instrument that we are using for that specific technique, right? And sometimes we don't have this opportunity. What we need to do then, we need to, we are gonna do the data processing, right? And after doing the data processing, we are gonna have the responses and we need to enter manually those responses into the software or using Excel or other kind of statistical software. And for sure, this will add some delay in the method development, but it's totally, I think it's totally fine. I think one of the hardest steps that we need to spend a bit of time is exactly data processing, because if you are doing the data processing in a wrong way or integrating the pigs incorrectly, you can add bias and mess up the prediction model, right?
Yeah. Another question here: have you experienced any cases that even after all these AQBD measures, the method developed becomes inadequate after some time has elapsed? So
no, I still haven't experienced this since, but this might happen, and this might be because we didn't select the critical parameters to be studied, or we didn't select the critical attributes to be studied. As I said, this is a very important step of AQBD, of the AQBD approach, because if we are not selecting the critical attributes, we will not be monitoring correctly, or we might not have the quality we would like to have at the end. Right. So this is a very important step to pay attention at the very beginning of the method design. Yeah.
There's another question. What is the practical risk if we wouldn't apply analytical QBD for analytical methods? As the MODR is not much allowable thing. I think this question is, slightly, can you read it as well on your end? It's at 4047.
Find this one, so. Okay, maybe you can find me. I didn't find this one, Christian.
Yeah. Let's take another one. You were saying that validation is not a direct measure of quality, but doesn't validation contribute to ensuring consistency, which is then in itself an element of quality?
Yeah, for sure. Actually, what I said is that some performance characteristics, such as accuracy, precision, etc., they are good indicators of performance. But during method design, those indicators may not provide a direct measure of the quality and error associated with the measurement, right? So we need to conduct or estimate the uncertainty associated with the result and with the measurement and also variability for us to be able to identify where we may face some lack of robustness.
Do you expect, Amanda, there's another question. Do you expect the analytical quality by design concept to be included in submission dossiers at some point?
This might be possible. We still see that there are some knowledge gaps for the industry to use and implement this, and it's the same for the regulatory agencies, right? So we are in a time that we need to exchange experiences and exchange knowledge on this. And I guess that after the ICH guideline is published on the Q14 is published, we might have a clear overview or view of how this might happen. Yeah.
Okay, we are coming to the end of today's webinar, but we might have time still for maybe one or two questions. I have one more here. In case we have a manufacturing process already developed using quality by design and already in GMP manufacturing, so if we want to move within design space to manufacture some product, will there be any regulatory consequences on the analytical quality by design then?
This might have some consequences, since in case it changes the organic impurity profile, for example, of my particular case study today, we might need to evaluate this. Yes.
Yeah, and I think the last question that we should take. Well, yeah, let's use that one here because it's a very general one, I would think. Do we have to validate all the parameters that are covered in my workspace? For example, if my method is workable throughout 30 to 55 degrees Celsius. So.
Yeah. Well, the idea is that by validating the MODR, then you just validate the final condition, right? So for this reason, it's so important that we work and start changing, exchanging knowledge around protocols for MODR validation, because it would not be necessary in the future to validate all working points within the MODR. This is the idea that we don't need to validate them, but we need to access and evaluate the performance requirements throughout the MODR.
Okay, thank you very much, Amanda, for all the answers to that questions, and also for this wonderful presentation. We got a lot of comments also that the participants liked this presentation very much and found it it sat perfect here as well. So very good results. And we could not answer all the questions here for today, but we have the chat protocols, and we'll try to answer as much of those offline as well. If you have further questions, or if you think your question has not been answered, then please reach out either to Amanda under awg@usp.org or to me, christian.seine@usp.org. My email address was also in the chat already mentioned. And with that, I give back the word to Jan for final words.
Yes, thank you very much, Christian. Thank you so much, Amanda, for this very interesting webinar and this great information you've provided. I hope for all our participants, this has been enjoyable for you as well and informative. Again, as Christian said, please reach out to us directly by email if you have any further questions and comments. We'll just make some quick announcements for the next rounds of webinars that we have scheduled for the Europe, Middle East, and Africa region. So on 29th of April, on Tuesday from 10 to 11, we have qualification of dissolution testers, USP performance verification test PVT. On 11th May, Thursday from 10 to 11:15, what you always wanted to know about USP reference standards, but were maybe afraid to ask. And on 20th May, Tuesday, we'll have general chapters, 12:20, Analytical Procedure Life Cycle with Dr. Rossio Papa, for those who might be already familiar with him. Amanda will be back with us on Tuesday, 1st of June, from 2 to 3, USP proposed general chapters 1469, Nitrosamine and Impurities. And on 15 June, Tuesday, from 10 to 11, we'll have the value from a Copil reference standards, which Christian will be presenting. All right. Well, thank you so much. Amanda, is there just something you just briefly want to mention for the Nitro webinar you have lined up for the 1st of June, or is it too early still?
No. I can share. Basically, we will be discussing about testing methods for nitrosamine analysis in pharmaceuticals and discussing about analytical challenges that we may face when developing methods and validating methods. And I also would like to share the 4 procedures that we have in the chapter 1469.
Excellent, thank you. And Christian, do you just want to just share something really quickly about for 15 June, the value of pharmacopeial reference standards and thoughts?
Yeah, that presentation is based on an article that we recently published in Pharmaceutical Technology. We will talk there about the risks that that you are taking if you don't set up secondary standards in the right way, for example, and we explain a little bit what the risks are there. We explain the guard band principle and look a little bit into uncertainties just for the sake of showing the risk there. So it's a presentation that was not shown so far to that regard. Yeah,
excellent. All right. If you would like to stay informed with further webinars that we have information, please visit our homepage at usp.org and select the tab that says products and services to subscribe to our newsletter, where you can receive regular updates so we can stay in touch. Thank you so much again. When you close the window, there should be a short survey that should pop up. So again, please, we welcome your feedback. Please be forthright and honest with us. It really will help us as well. And thank you so much, everyone, for participating. Please stay safe, please stay healthy, and we hope to welcome you back soon.
All right. Thank you very much, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.